Amen. So, Dwayne and I are going to be sharing about the grace of God. And of course, this is what changed my life. Just real quickly, I know most of you have heard this, so I'm not going to go into detail. But I got born again when I was 8 years old, the very first time that I ever really understood that I had sinned against God, not just my parents. And I knew that I needed a Savior. I got born again the very first time I was convicted of that. And I've been seeking God my whole life, but I became a religious Pharisee. I didn't mean to, but that's what my denomination taught me, that you had to earn the things of God. And so I tried harder than anybody I knew. And I don't mean that in a conceited way. It's just the truth. I mean, I gave everything I knew to seeking the Lord. And I've been seeking God my entire life, but I thought that God would respond to me. And if I lived holy enough and did enough good things, then God would accept me. And it never worked. My dad died when I just turned 12, just a couple of weeks after I turned 12. And I prayed for him for 6 weeks, fasted as an 11-year-old, and did everything I knew to try and get God to heal my dad. And it didn't work. And I saw all kinds of things happen, and I was frustrated, but I thought, well, I just need to try harder. And so I was just trying harder and harder. And then on March the 23rd, 1968, God showed up, and I saw him in all of his glory. I didn't see it with my eyes, but I got a revelation. And this is one of the things I'll say a number of times, even tonight and maybe some other times, and I know that Dwayne agrees with it, that you have to receive grace by revelation. You can't argue a person into it. You can't show it to them, and you can't grab it intellectually. It has to come by revelation. And I don't have any words to describe, but on March the 23rd, 1968, I saw the glory of God. And the scripture says in Romans 3:23 that all of sin comes short of the glory of God. And man, I saw all of my religious works that I was so proud of and trusting in my goodness. And boy, compared to the glory of God, I saw myself, man, as a sinner. I deserved to go to hell. Now, I was already born again, but that didn't change the fact that in my actions, I wasn't worthy of anything. In my spirit, I was born again, but my actions were just not worthy of anything from God. And I saw it and I knew it. And long story, but man, I confessed it. And when I finally humbled myself and quit trusting in my own goodness, the love of God was just poured out in my life. And I mean, for 4.5 months, I was caught up in the presence of God. And it was wonderful, but it was confusing. And when the emotion wore off, then I tried to figure out what happened and how did this happen? What did I do to lose the emotion of it? What do I have to do to get it back? And I mean, frustration set in. And one of the best things that ever happened was I got drafted and sent to Vietnam, and I was taken away from all religious instruction. I didn't have anybody to teach me. And for 13 months in Vietnam, I just sat in a bunker, and to keep my mind stayed on God, I just started reading the Bible. And God started showing me through the Word of God about grace. And it just has literally revolutionized my life. And so I'm going to be sharing things with you about that. And I know Dwayne will too. And basically what I'm going to do, I'm not going to be limited to this, but I'm going to start here in Galatians, and I'm going to teach from Galatians. The book of Romans is, I believe, Paul's masterpiece on grace. It's just a real scholarly approach to it. And I tell you, if Romans isn't one of your favorite books, you do not understand grace. If you do understand grace, I can guarantee you Romans is one of your favorite books, because it is just Paul's masterpiece on grace. Galatians is teaching the exact same things, but it's not a scholarly approach. I mean, Paul is angry. Paul is ticked off at these Galatians and just saying things to them like, man, he put a curse on anybody who would violate what he said over in the third chapter. I'll be dealing with these things in more detail, but he says, you foolish Galatians, called them fools. Did you know Jesus said that you're in danger of hell fire if you call somebody a fool? So I don't believe that means you can't do it. You just better be really sure. Because if you call a good person a fool, you're in trouble. And so anyway, Paul said, you foolish Galatians. And then in the fifth chapter, he says, Christ is profiting you nothing. Now these were people who were born again. And yet if you don't understand grace, if you are trying to relate to God based on your own goodness, Christ profits you nothing. And I couldn't tell you how many Christians I've ministered to. I mean, tens of thousands of Christians over 54 years of ministry, that Christ is profiting them nothing. Now, when they get to heaven, maybe, you know, they got a ticket to heaven and that's going to be great. But as far as this life goes, they can't receive healing. They can't receive joy. They aren't prosperous. They're depressed. They're discouraged. They're fearful. If they were arrested for being a Christian, there wouldn't be any more evidence to convict them than their unsaved neighbor. They're a Christian in name only. They aren't experiencing the blessing of God. And Paul is saying in Galatians chapter 5 that it's because you are trusting in your own works to be justified, to be accepted with God. Satan's only accusation against you is to come against your performance. And the good news is, the nearly too good to be true news is, that God doesn't deal with you based on your performance. He deals with you based on Jesus' performance, and all you have to do to access that is believe. Romans chapter 5 verse 2 says, we have access into this grace through faith. And so the way you get into God's grace is to believe and receive. And did you know one of the things that hinders most people from receiving from God is their own goodness? That's not to say that you shouldn't be doing what's right. But if your trust is in your own goodness, that's the very thing that's standing between you and God. When you are saying, God, I deserve this, you ought to be praising God that He's not giving you what you deserve. Because you'd burn in hell if you did. And even after you're born again, if He gave you what you deserve based on your actions, you wouldn't receive anything. You can only receive from God through grace, not through your own performance. And so anyway, let me just start here in the book of Galatians. I'm not going to teach verse by verse, but I want to at least lay the foundation for this. Like I said, he had ministered to these Galatians a very short period of time before this. The book of Galatians was written to an area called Galatia, and the main cities there were Lystra, Iconium, and Derbe. And you can read about that in the starting in the 13th chapter of the book of Acts. And Paul went to these places on each one of his missionary journeys. And so this is right after his first missionary journey, somewhere in the early 50 AD category, or in that range. And he was ministering to these people, and he starts, I'm not going to read every one of these verses, but he starts by saying, Paul, an apostle. And what he's doing is establishing his authority. He's showing these people that, hey, I am an apostle of God. I'm the one that brought the gospel to you, and I have a right to speak into your life as a parent. And let me just point out one verse here. This is one of the verses that has meant a lot to me. In Galatians 1:4, he says, talking about Jesus, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world. You know, I was raised in a denomination that we sang songs about when we all get to heaven, what a day that's going to be, in the sweet by and by. But boy, in the rough now and now, there wasn't much. I mean, you just were saved and stuck until you get to heaven. And so we were focused on heaven because you didn't get healed, you didn't have joy, you couldn't have prosperity. There is nothing until you got to heaven. This says that he gave himself to deliver us from this present evil world. Boy, that really ministered to me, especially in the early days when I was coming out from all of that wrong teaching and stuff. And I realized that even though heaven's going to be a blast, and I'm not trying to minimize that at all, this is awesome, walking in what God has provided for us here. And I mean, you can have heaven on earth. Matter of fact, the book of Proverbs says that if you seek God, that your days will be as heaven on earth. Jesus prayed and said, Father, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we can experience victory. It's not just, you know, pie in the sky by and by, but it's steak on the plate while you wait. Amen. That's awesome. And so right after he says these very few words of introduction, he jumps right into it. Look at this in verse 6. He says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. And so he's using the word grace and gospel interchangeably. This same thing is done in Acts chapter 20, verse 24, where Paul said, you know, that he was called to preach the gospel of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. So there's a number of times that Paul used the term grace and gospel interchangeably. So let me say it this way, that if people aren't talking about the grace of God, then it's not the gospel. We've gotten to where we use the word gospel as a religious term, that we don't really think about what it means. And people will stand up and say, you're going to hell, repent or else, turn or burn. And then they'll say, that's the gospel. That's not the gospel. Amen. The word gospel literally means good news. And I've often said this, but I've studied out that Greek word that was translated gospel. And I read in a commentary that it was so rarely used that there's only two examples of that Greek word being used outside of the Bible, because it literally meant more than just good news. It was like it was nearly too good to be true news. And there was nothing in this natural world that was nearly too good to be true news. So it was rarely used. But when Jesus came along and provided salvation, not based on what we do, but based on what he did, that word, the gospel, fit that perfectly. And this is what the Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it, the gospel, the grace of God, is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And I believe that you could say that the gospel, the grace of God, is the power of God unto healing. Because salvation isn't limited to just forgiveness of sins. It's also talking about healing of your body. The exact word that's used, sozo, literally was translated like in James chapter 5, if anybody is sick, let him call for the elders of the church, anoint him with oil and pray over him, and the prayer of faith will sozo save the sick. That exact word that was translated salvation, saved, is talking about the healing of your body. It's also talking about prosperity. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, that Jesus became poor so that we through his poverty might be made rich. That's part of the atonement. It's also talking about deliverance, and on you could go. So salvation isn't only talking about the initial born again experience. The gospel is the power of God unto healing, deliverance, joy, peace. If you are struggling in any one of those areas, this is a big statement, but it's absolutely true. If you are struggling in healing, if you're struggling in joy, if you're struggling in peace, if you're struggling in finances, you are struggling understanding the grace of God, because the grace of God is the thing that releases power for all of these things. So Paul is using the term grace and gospel interchangeably. And he said in verse 7, let me go back again to verse 6. He says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. And this word for another here is talking about another of a different kind. And let me just say it this way, that if you aren't talking about the grace of God, then it's not the true gospel. It's another gospel, and it's not a true gospel at all. And in verse 7, he says, which is not another. In other words, it's not a gospel different. It's a perversion of the gospel. I didn't say that as good as I wanted to, but let me say this, that the thing that makes what's going on in the church today so bad is it's not a completely different gospel. They will say that they believe in Jesus. They will preach the gospel to a degree, but then they'll mix other things with it. So it's not like it's, you know, if people just came out, we were talking with Caroline and Virginia tonight, and they came out of a church group where the guy actually stood up there and said something about Jesus is not God. Now, see, if you say something like that, that's pretty obvious. You can walk away from that. But when people say, oh yeah, Jesus is God, and oh yeah, you've got to trust on Jesus to be saved. But then once you get saved, you better live holy, you better pay your tithes, go to church, do this, this, and this. And God's not going to answer your prayer if you aren't living holy. And here's the reason he's not doing things is because you aren't worthy. Now see, that is a perversion of the gospel. And that's harder to deal with than a person that just totally rejects everything. And so this is what Paul's talking about. It's not like it's a completely different gospel. The people that were troubling the Galatians were what they called Judaizers. And they were people who were Jews who had converted to Christianity. They believed that Jesus was the Messiah. And they preached that you had to put faith in Jesus to be born again. But after you got born again, you also had to keep all of the Jewish rituals, and the book of Galatians is going to focus primarily on circumcision, which is not that's not the only issue. It just was the main thing in the Jewish culture that the males had to be circumcised. But the same thing operates today. It may not be circumcision, but it could be the way you're baptized. You have to be baptized in the name of Jesus, or you have to worship on an exact day, or you have to keep all of these things. It's the same principle. And matter of fact, in the fifth chapter, when we get over there, he'll say the same thing. He said that Christ will profit you nothing if you're circumcised. And then in the next verse, he says, as many of you as are justified by the law, you have fallen from grace. And so he's using falling from grace interchangeably. It's not that one action. It's just this mentality that you've got to do things in order to be worthy for God to move in your life. And that is what he's preaching against right here. And then he said this. This is just phenomenal. In verse 8, he says, but though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which you have preached, which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. The word accursed here is the Greek word anathema, and it means utterly destroyed. Matter of fact, today's English version says, let them go to hell is what it's talking about. That's the exact terminology. This is phenomenal. Paul is saying, if anybody preaches any other gospel, and again, the word gospel and grace are used interchangeably. If anybody is mixing stuff with the gospel, let them be accursed. Let them be cast into hell. And that's a strong statement, especially when Paul's the one that said over in Romans chapter 12, bless and curse not. And yet here he is putting a curse on anybody who mixes other stuff with it. And I'm sure that this was just an absolute shock to these Galatians. And they must have thought, he can't mean what he's saying. So he says in the next verse, as we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which you have received, let him be accursed. In other words, just in case anybody missed it or thought, surely he's just making this bigger than it is. He repeated it and he says, if anybody, even an angel, preaches anything unto you other than the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be accursed. Brothers and sisters, the body of Christ as a whole today, again, there are individual churches and individual people that are preaching the gospel and doing it correctly, but as a whole, the body of Christ today is preaching a perverted gospel. They aren't preaching the true gospel, and according to Paul's own statement here, they should be accursed. That's a strong statement. I believe that if Jesus was here in his physical body, the way that he ripped the Pharisees, the scribes and the Pharisees, they had all the religious trappings. Man, they even counted how many steps they could walk on a Sabbath day. They wouldn't break the Sabbath. They paid tithes down to the mint and the anise and cumin, the spices that grew in their garden. They prayed three times a day. And they just did on and on. You could go talking about all of the things that they did. The things that they were doing wasn't wrong, but it was the fact that they put their trust in what they were doing And Jesus blasted them. The entire 23rd chapter of the book of Matthew is Jesus saying, "You vipers." You know, today they get mad. They got mad at Trump for calling the MS-13 people dogs. Jesus called people vipers, talking about the religious people. "And you whited sepulchers, you're hypocrites, you're full of dead man's bones." He said things that I guarantee you, he blasted these people. I believe Jesus, if he was here in his physical body and if he was ministering today, he wouldn't be the way that he's portrayed often, where he's got this little effeminate look on his face and he's sitting there with his fingers like this and he's just telling everybody, you know, kumbaya, and we're all just having a good time. I guarantee you, Jesus would rip the church today for misrepresenting his gospel. Bill Federer, during this conference, man, he made a great point of this, that people now are trying to be more Christian than Christ. They think that you should never say anything, that this offends people if you say that homosexuality is wrong or transgenderism is wrong or boys shouldn't be competing in girls' sports, that makes people feel uncomfortable. We just need to love them. I guarantee you, Jesus did not respond to the evil of his day that way. He pointed it out and he called a spade a shovel. Amen. And this is what Paul is doing. I'm quoting him. This isn't me. He says, if anybody, even an angel, preaches something else to you, let him be accursed. I guarantee you, there's a reason that the church is not having a greater impact today. And it's because we have abandoned the truth of God's word, and the church has become woke. Not the whole church, but a large portion of it. You got Raphael Warnock trying to use the Bible to say that Jesus would support abortion. That's an out and out lie. Gavin Newsom quoted Jesus and said, "Love your neighbor as yourself," to support abortion, saying that we should love women and be for them and help them to get an abortion. Man, that's demonic that you would take the words of Jesus and twist it like that. I guarantee you, because we grow up in it, we don't recognize it sometimes. You know, this is one of the reasons we make our Bible college students go on a foreign missions trip in their second year, is because you grow up in a culture and things kind of sneak up on you. It's just the way that it's always been, and we don't think about it. But when you go to another culture, it's easier to see because you didn't grow up in that, and it's easier for you to recognize the error of it. But I tell you what, there's a lot of junk in the body of Christ today. We have this guy that I was talking about that Billy and I interviewed yesterday on the Inside Story, and he's a CFO for Kappen and Krauss, and he's also our CFO. But he said that there's like 23,000 churches that probably will never open back up after the COVID closures and stuff like that. And, you know, I'm thinking, praise God. That's God shaking the body and getting rid of some of this dead weight. And if every person I know, Dwayne's church, you could just go down the row, and Lawson Purdue and other people I know, anybody who's preaching the word of God, their churches have grown exponentially during the pandemic. Their income has increased. Because people are getting tired of all this wokeness, and they're wanting somebody who'll stand up and preach the word of God and speak the truth. And the people who are speaking the truth are growing. We had Rob McCoy here, who's out in California, and Gavin Newsom fined him. I forgot how much it was, but it was in the millions of dollars because they went ahead and held meetings, and he took it to the Supreme Court and won and had all of that canceled. But his church has increased fourfold since they came out against him. People are looking for somebody that'll stand up and speak the truth. Amen. You know, I heard a story about a kid that was a pastor's son, and his friends wanted him to go see a movie, and it was rated R. And so he asked his dad if he could go see the movie, and his dad says, "What's it rated?" And he told him, and he says, "But it's really not that bad. There's just a tiny bit of nudity in it, just a little bit of profanity, but it's really okay. The other kids from church are going to go. Their parents are letting them go. Can I go? And the dad said, no, you can't go. And the kid was really disappointed. And so the dad said, you can invite your friends over to the house. And so he invited them over to the house, and they were out playing in the backyard, and the dad came out, and he had fixed some brownies. And he brought the brownies out fresh out of the oven, and the kids were getting them and, you know, about to eat them. And he said, now wait, but right before you eat it, I want you to know that there's just a little bit of dog poop in those brownies. Says there's not enough to make it taste bad. It won't make you sick. It won't do any that. It's okay. It's just a tiny bit, but I just wanted you to know there's a little bit of dog poop in these brownies. Do you think they ate them? But see, we sit there and tolerate just a little bit of stuff. I do admit that, you know, there are certain things that are non-negotiable, and there's other things that are external. I had a guy present it one time as like a target, you know, with the bullseye, and then you got the other rings that go out and out. And the further away you get from the bullseye, the less important it is. And so there's some things that I'm not going to argue with people over, like whether you get dunked or sprinkled, or if you just hold them under until they really repent, you know. I mean, there's some things that we can sit there and it's not in the center, but this gospel grace is something that you can't compromise on. And this not only is a strong statement from Paul, but think about how confident he was in what he was preaching. Look at the next verse here. In verse 10, he says, for do I now persuade man or God? Or do I seek to please man? For if I yet please man, I should not be the servant of Christ. Amen. In other words, Paul had just said, if anybody preaches anything to you other than what I have preached to you, let him be accursed. And then he says, am I the one that's persuading people, or is it God speaking through me? He's basically saying, look, this isn't me. Matter of fact, over in Thessalonians, when he told the Thessalonians, he says, you received the word not as the word of man, but as it is in truth, the word of God that lives and abides forever. It says in 1 Peter, I believe it's chapter 4, verse 11, if any man speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. That's referring to the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was. If we're going to preach, you need to be sure enough about what you're saying that you can stand up and say, man, it's not me talking, it's God speaking through me. And if anybody preaches anything to you other than what I've preached, let him be accursed. If you aren't that confident of what you're saying, you shouldn't be preaching. There's not many people that'll stand up and say things like that. In the church today, people say, well, I believe. Here's my opinion. Here's what I think. This is the way that our modern church is. It's people talking about God, but there's very few people that will sit there and believe that God is actually speaking through them. And one of the reasons for that is because most people got their message from somebody else. They're parroting what they've heard other people say. It's an echo instead of a voice. That's not what God called us to be. And Paul said, if I am pleasing men, I am not the servant of Christ. Now, again, this doesn't mean that you go out of your way to offend everybody. There will be people that'll be pleased with what you preach. But it's saying that if you are out to please people, if you are ministering so that people will give you recognition and do things for you, then you aren't a true servant of Christ. Jesus said it this way in John chapter 5, verse 44. He says, how can you believe which receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that comes from God alone? Jesus is saying, if you are a man pleaser, you can't truly be in faith. You can't be pleasing God and pleasing to men, all men, at the same time. Jesus said, beware when all men speak well of you. Man, I don't have to worry about that one. I got front page ads to prove that not everybody's speaking well of me. And Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, he says, all those who will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. If you aren't being persecuted, the only reason for it is because you aren't godly. If you're godly, you will be persecuted. And specifically, when you start preaching about the grace of God and saying it's not your goodness, it's not your holiness, it's not what you do for God, but it's what God did for you. When you start preaching that, all of the religious demons will rise up and come against you. Did you know that every other religion on the planet preaches that there is a God? They have some concept of God, but basically they are preaching what you do have to do to appease an angry God. And the burden of salvation is on your shoulders. True Christianity is different from every other religion on the planet in the sense that if instead of talking about what you have to do, it says that you are in sin. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is nothing you can do to save yourself. You can't make yourself worthy in the sight of God. And so therefore, God Himself became a man, and God took the judgment, the punishment that was against you and me, and He brought it into His own body, and He paid for your sins. Did you know that there is no other religion on the planet that even has any concept like that? I believe that Satan couldn't even imagine that God would do this. To think that God Almighty, you know, I was just studying in Psalms 36, 6, I believe it is. Could you put that verse up there so I don't have to turn over to Psalms 36, 6? It says, His righteousness is like the great mountains, the judgment. Oh, that's not it. But that's a good one. But it's Psalms 36, something, right there close. And it says, out of His mouth came everything. The breath of His mouth created everything. Is that it? The words of His mouth are iniquity. Well, that's not it. I know it's right there someplace. But He's talking about by the breath of His mouth was everything created. Think about the sun. They estimate that the sun, the temperature of the sun on the surface is 10,000 degrees Celsius or something like that. That came out of His mouth. There it is. What was that, verse? 33:6. Why'd you say 36? By the word of the Lord were the heavens made and all the host of them by the breath of His mouth. So the sun, and our sun is one of the smaller suns, out of His mouth came the sun, came the entire universe. It says that He can put the entire universe, which they estimate to be 496 billion light years wide and still expanding at the speed of light. It says that He can put the universe in the span of His hand. You know, this is the reason I believe that the scripture says no man can see God and live. It's not because if you catch a glimpse of Him, it's like He's shy. And if you catch a glimpse of Him, He's going to kill you. It's because He is so awesome. He's so infinite that if you were to see God in His glory, you would explode. You couldn't contain God. God can hold the entire universe in the palm of His hand. And yet this infinite God put Himself in a physical body and came down and died for our sins. That is phenomenal. Christianity is the only religion, if you want to call it a religion, that has this concept. It's not what you do that makes you accepted with God. It's what He did for you, and all you've got to do is humble yourself and just receive it by grace. And this is why grace is offensive, because religious people, people who are trusting in their goodness, they will be offended when you start saying that the guy over here who has never done anything good has the same access to God that you do through Jesus. Because they're saying, well, you're saying all of my righteousness and all of my goodness doesn't make me any better than them? Yes, that's exactly what we're saying. Now, there is benefit to you living a holy life. You know, Jamie and I grew up in a religious church, and I'm 73 now. I've never said a word of profanity, never taken a drink of liquor, never smoked a cigarette. And because of that, there's benefit to me. I don't have to deal with lung cancer. I don't have to deal with some of the guilt, some of the things that other people deal with. I haven't been in jail. I haven't gone through some. There are benefits, but it doesn't benefit me with God. Who wants to be the best sinner that ever got rejected? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. When it comes to God, my holiness doesn't do a thing. There is benefit to living a godly life to keep Satan away and to keep me from having some problems. So I praise God for my background. But I guarantee you, when it comes to relationship with God, all of the ground is level at the foot of the cross. There's nobody who's got to step up on another person. Every one of us has to humble ourselves. And this is why religious people don't like grace, because you're saying that this old drunk over here, God loves him as much as he loves me. I've done all of these things. But the Bible says in James 2:10, if you keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, you become guilty of all. That is a radical statement. And it's amazing how people who are legalists forget this point. And they just assume, well, you know, I've actually told people before who criticize me for preaching on grace. And they say, man, you're encouraging sin. You're saying that people can live in sin and God still loves them. I believe you got to live holy for God to love you and God to move in your life. And I've told them, I said, so do you live holy? Well, I don't do things perfectly, but at least I don't dip or cuss or chew or go with those that do. At least I'm better than this publican over here. See, that's the Pharisee syndrome. And so the very people who are sitting there preaching that you've got to be worthy and you've got to live holy in order for God to move in your life, if you grill them, well, no, I'm not perfect, but. And so what they're doing is preaching that it's your effort plus Jesus. They are mixing it. They're putting a little bit of poop in there. The moment you mix your goodness with what Jesus did, you have just put your poop into the equation. I guarantee you, Jesus plus none of your poop equals victory. But you start putting your effort in there and you contaminate the entire thing. It says in Romans chapter 11, verse 6, it says, it's either grace without works, otherwise it's not true grace, or it's works without grace, otherwise works isn't really works. That's just the old English way of saying it's one or the other. You cannot say that it's your goodness plus Jesus making up the difference. You either have a Savior who paid for everything 100%, and all you got to do is believe and receive, or you got to have the whole burden of producing on your shoulders, but it's not a combination of the two. Man, these are awesome, awesome things that he's saying. In verse 11, he says, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man, for I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my conversation, and just for time's sake, I'm going to skip through the rest of this. But what he's doing is saying that, look, nobody told me this. He says, when I got born again, it was on the road to Damascus. Then in Damascus, he preached for a time or two in Damascus, but they were going to try and kill him. So they had to let him down in a basket over the city wall. And he fled into the deserts of Arabia. And then he says, 3 years later, he went up to Jerusalem and communicated with Peter. And he also saw John for 15 days. And that's the only contact he had with the other apostles. He didn't learn this from somebody. He went into the deserts of Arabia and he got it by revelation from the Holy Spirit. And this is what I was saying at the very beginning. You can't get the gospel any other way. You can listen to Dwayne and me minister this weekend, but you need to, the Holy Spirit has to reveal these things to you. It's so different. There's no model for grace. This world system, everything in this world system is based on performance. Your parents, when you came home and sang, you know, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, now I've said my ABCs, what do you think of me? And they had, oh, we're so proud of you. And they'd give you a reward, but you mess up and boom, they'd let you have it. It was all performance based. You go to school, you have to perform. You have to pass grades. When you get a job, you got to perform. And there's a performance review every year. And if you don't measure up, they'll fire you. It'll affect your ability to be promoted. You go out here and break the law, they're gonna punish you for it unless you live in California. They'll reward you for it. But you know what? The whole world is based on performance. Even marriages, they shouldn't be this way. But I've counseled people when Jamie and I were pastors in churches. We'd have people come in and I'd say, you're supposed to love your wife. Well, I know that, but... And then they'd tell me what the wife did, and that would justify them not loving their wife. In other words, I only love them if they deserve to be loved. So even marriages with most people is based on performance. Everything in this natural world is based on performance, but... The gospel is all about Jesus' performance. The only thing you have to contribute is your sin. Jesus died for sinners. So if you're a sinner, you qualify. If you're promoting any of your holiness, that disqualifies you. He died for the ungodly. So you have to be ungodly in order to be saved. You have to admit you're ungodly. Truth is, you are. You just have to admit that you're ungodly and recognize that you can't save yourself. So anyway, the rest of this chapter is him just sitting there saying, look, I got this by revelation. He talks about God revealed himself to him in verse 15. Let me go down to chapter 2. And in verse 1, he says, then 14 years after I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and took Titus with me also. This is recorded in the 15th chapter of the book of Acts, and it's where the church had a big conference because they had heard Paul and Barnabas were teaching in Antioch, and they were Gentiles were being born again, and the Jews didn't believe that you could be saved unless you were a Jew. So if you came to the Lord, yes, you had to make Jesus your Lord as Messiah, but then you also had to become a Jew. You had to be circumcised and you had to start keeping all of the rituals. And when they heard that people in Antioch, Gentiles, were being saved and they weren't circumcising them and they weren't making them Jews, which this is an aside, I probably shouldn't say that. I'll just say it real quickly and go on, but... You know, this whole thing about Messianic Jews, I believe, is not good. Amen. It's okay for you to be a Jew and be born again and claim that I'm a completed Jew and I'm a Messianic Jew in that sense. That's okay. But to put people back under the law and you got to now keep the feast and you got to start doing these things and wear your hair a certain way and dress like a Hasidic Jew and all of those kind of things, that is going back under law and legalism. And you look at all of the Jewish rabbis that are Christians now and preaching, and I guarantee you they are mixing their poop in with what Jesus did. They're mixing all of their goodness in there. I'll let Dwayne explain that when he gets up here. So when he went up to this conference to debate about should, Gentiles become Jews, he says in verse 2, and I went up by revelation. In other words, it wasn't something he was taught. He went up by the revelation that God gave him and communicated unto them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain. Boy, this is a little bit of an aside, but this is a great lesson in authority and how you're supposed to deal with things. Because Paul, he even said that when I met with these guys, I found out that they had nothing to add to me. I wasn't a whit behind any of them, even though I was like one born out of due time. That's just his old English of saying that he was as knowledgeable as any of them. Matter of fact, they even said in the 15th chapter of the book of Acts that they assented to what Paul said. And Paul, you're right. And they put their stamp of approval on it. So here he is saying, but when he went there, because he was on their turf, because they, in a sense, the pastors of that church, they were the ones in authority. Paul didn't rebuke them openly. He talked to them privately, honoring their position, not wanting to expose them in front of their congregation. But you can go on and read here in the second chapter, and again, I probably won't get this tonight, but he said, when Peter came to Antioch, he said, I rebuked him openly in front of them all. When Peter came on Paul's turf, and Paul was the one in authority, Paul rebuked Peter openly. A guy who spent 3.5 years being an intimate disciple of Jesus, Paul knew his authority and he rebuked Peter. But it shows you that when you go into another person's church, you aren't the one in authority. You need to respect that authority. And even though you may have a superior revelation, you don't sit there and undercut the authority. I've been in churches before where I remember one time up in the Chicago area, I went to a church and the guy got me before the service. And he said, look, I've been believing in healing, believing it's God's will, but his wife had just died of cancer. And he says, now I reject all of that stuff and I forbid you to speak on healing in this service. And I said, look, I don't like people telling me what I can say. I said, I'll just leave. I don't have to preach. And he said, no, we got people coming from everywhere. I want you to preach, but I'm telling you, don't you dare speak on that. And rather than me just sit there and bow my neck and fight this guy, I wasn't going to get in his pulpit and undercut him and turn people against him because I was going to leave. He had to stay there. That would be the wrong thing to do. So anyway, I forgot exactly what I preached on, but it was done in such a way that by the end of the service, he got up in front of the church and apologized. And he says, you know what? I compromised because I didn't see the word work in my life. But he says, I now know that it's part of what Jesus provided. And anyway, it worked out. But I didn't come in and attack this guy is what I'm saying. I wouldn't go into a person's church and attack them. That's not what God's called me to do. But you come here and you get up on my stage and you go to preaching stuff, I'll stand up and correct it. I've got a responsibility to do that. That's what Paul was doing here. And look at this in verse 3. He says, but neither Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, that's a Gentile, was compelled to be circumcised, and that because of false brethren, unawares brought in, who came in privately to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage. You know, over in Acts chapter 16, verse 3, it says that when Timothy got saved, Paul took him and circumcised him because of all of the Jews in that area. And he did it so that he would take away criticism against him. But with Titus, he said specifically he did not circumcise him. And the reason why was in verse 4, because of the Jews that came in privately to spy out their liberty. So I know this may be a little uncomfortable for some of you, but Paul's the one that wrote it, and so I'm just going to say it. But let me ask you this. How do you tell if a person's circumcised? It's not like you can just tell by looking. They were looking under the stalls in the latrine. They were checking on Titus to see if he was circumcised. Did you know that religious people will do more ungodly things to you because they're criticizing your liberty? They will do things that are terrible in the name of the Lord. Man, we were just talking to Caroline in Virginia down here about people, if they wore makeup, if they wore pants, if they wore glasses, you went directly to hell, and they would just be mean to people. And that meanness and the judgment is much worse than anything that any of them would ever do. This is amazing to me how these Jews thought somehow or another they had the high moral ground, and yet they were peeking on people as they went to the toilet. Religion is crazy. Religion will kill you. It's bad stuff. So let me close with this. I got 37 seconds. Will you give me 5 more minutes? How many of you give me 5 minutes? There's 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. I got you. Amen. I learned that from, who was that? Mario, I think, did that. All right. So he says down here, this is talking about him rebuking Peter in verse 14. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou being a Jew livest after the manner of the Gentiles and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? In other words, nobody ever keeps the law perfectly. And if you can't keep the law and have to depend upon grace, well, then why do you preach to other people about how they've got to keep the law and stuff? It's grace that is the only thing that makes any of us be able to receive and approach God. It says, we are who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. I've got an entire teaching on this. Matter of fact, I just wrote a little booklet about 30 pages trying to explain this, that you aren't justified by faith in Jesus. You are justified by the faith of Jesus. Huge difference between those two. A huge difference. It's Jesus' faith that justifies you. It's Jesus that did everything. And all you got to do is just by faith receive it. But you are using the faith of Jesus. It says again in verse 16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ. Again, it's not wrong to say that you've put faith in Jesus, but it's important that you recognize that you putting faith in Him means that His faith gets credited to you. You are justified by the faith of Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Strong statement. Again, if you go back to James 2:10, if you keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, you become guilty of all. It doesn't matter how hard you try, you can't do everything perfectly. And if you can't do everything perfectly, if you miss it in one thing, you become guilty of everything. I have never done some of the things that many of you have. But did you know I'm just as guilty as you are? It's like if you had a huge piece of glass in front of me and you could shoot a BB through it or drive a Mack truck through it. But if you break it, the whole thing is broken. The whole thing has to be replaced. Matter of fact, over in James 2:10, if you read the next couple of verses, it says, well, I can't quote it, so let me just read this. I'm coming right back. But in James chapter 2, verse 10, it says, if you keep, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not kill. Now, if thou commit no adultery, yet if thou kill, thou art become a transgressor of the law. So I've never committed adultery, but I'm guilty of committing adultery because I've broken the law of God. I've never killed, but I'm guilty of murder. So are you. Thank you for that thunderous silence. If you've broken anything, there's a guy in Colorado Springs that preaches that if you, well, he's gone on to be with the Lord now, but he used to preach that if you went 56 miles an hour in a 55 mile an hour zone and had a car wreck, you would die and go to hell because you didn't have time to repent of that sin. Most people say, well, I don't believe that. Well, let me ask you this. What if you committed adultery and on the way home you had a car wreck and didn't repent of that? All of a sudden, many people would say, well, 56 miles an hour, that's okay. But adultery, I believe you'd go to hell if you have an unconfessed sin in your life. If I really believed you'd go to hell with an unconfessed sin in your life, then the moment you get born again, I'd kill you. That's the only way you'd ever make it. The Bible says in Romans 14:23, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. If you aren't operating in faith, you're in sin. And I guarantee you, there's many people that aren't in faith concerning healing, prosperity, joy, peace, marriage, something. And it also says in James 4:17, to him that knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin. So if sin isn't only violating a commandment, But sin is failing to do all of the good things that you know you're supposed to do. You know you're supposed to love God more than you do. You know you're supposed to study the Word more than you do. You know that you're supposed to love your mate more than you do. And yet all of us fail constantly. If you had to have no sin, no unconfessed sin in your life for God to move in your life, then I'd be doing you a favor to kill you the moment you got born again, because that's the only way you'd ever make it to heaven. That is not what the Word of God teaches. Amen. And then let me just end with this. Verse 20, Galatians 2:20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Not faith in the Son of God, but by the faith of the Son of God. Jesus gave you His faith. Romans 12:3 says every man is dealt the measure of faith. I'm aware that the NIV says a measure of faith, but you ought to get you a real Bible. It's the measure of faith, and it says it twice in the 16th verse, and then again in the 20th verse right here, it says the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. You have God's supernatural faith given to you. Galatians 5:22 and 23 says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Faith is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. You have the faith of the Son of God. And since there's only one measure, you have the same amount that Paul had, which was the faith of the Son of God. Peter, over in 2 Peter chapter 1, unto them who have obtained like precious faith. That word like precious faith means identical faith. You've got the faith of God in your spirit. Now, you may not have it out here in your mind, and you may not be walking in it and acting like it, but in your heart, you have the faith of the Son of God. You don't have a faith problem. You got a knowledge problem. Philemon chapter 1 verse 6 says he prays that the communication of your faith would become effectual by acknowledging all of the good things that are in you in Christ Jesus. One of the first steps in seeing the faith of God operate in your life is to quit saying, God, I don't have any faith, because you're only searching your physical and your mental emotional part. But in your spirit, you have the faith of the Son of God. And acknowledging that is the first step to seeing it work. Amen. But these are strong, strong statements here. And then the last verse, he says, I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness come by the law, you could say if righteousness comes through what you do, through your holiness, through you adhering to something, then Christ is dead in vain. Man, Jesus coming to this earth is the greatest thing that God ever did. But if you seek to be accepted in the sight of God based on your goodness, then as far as your life is concerned, Christ will profit you nothing. Christ is dead in vain. And brothers and sisters, this is the number one thing. It's not sin. I'm not for sin. And I'm sure Dwayne and I will try and put all of this in its proper perspective during this time. You should be living a holy life. But sin is not the problem. The biggest thing hindering people is them trusting in their own goodness. Very few people doubt that God has unlimited power and that He could do anything. What they doubt is that He would do it for them because they feel unworthy. And the truth is, you are unworthy. In your flesh, you don't deserve it. But the good news, the nearly too good to be true news is you aren't going to get what you deserve. You get what Jesus deserves, and all you have to do is just believe in His grace and receive it by grace instead of receiving it by works. Amen. So this is the introduction to our grace encounter. And I tell you, I said a mouthful tonight. And I pray that you just let the Holy Spirit help you to understand it. And we're going to be saying, I'm sure Dwayne will be teaching on a lot of the exact same things, but we'll be saying it from our standpoint. And so I don't believe we'll contradict. It'll just give an added dimension to it. It'll help you to understand it. Amen. Let's all stand up. Let's have our prayer ministers come down here tonight. And if you need prayer, we will be here to pray with you. Some of you, maybe for the first time in a long time, your faith is directed back towards Jesus. And even though you may not have done everything right, now you're ready to put faith in what Jesus did instead of faith in what you're doing. And so we welcome you to come down here and receive prayer. Father, we just love you and we thank you. Father, I believe that the Holy Spirit is opening up our hearts and helping us, Father, to receive these truths on grace by revelation. That, Father, you would reveal this to people. Father, I pray that we would see your great love and be overwhelmed with your goodness, not our goodness. That we would humble ourselves and just receive everything that we need by grace. Those who need healing and have been trying to perform and earn it, I pray that they would just let go of all of the things they're trying to do to earn it and just humble themselves and receive it by grace tonight. Father, those that need to be delivered from discouragement, depression, all kinds of other things, we just thank you that tonight you help people to humble themselves and we receive your goodness as gift. And so we thank you for it, Father. We agree and we receive it tonight in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So we've got our people down here. Please come and let them pray. Have you got some announcements, Claire? All right, here's Claire back.